So welcome back to DeepSec 2009, second day. Next talk will be by Lutz Donnerhacke. And I see less people in this room, but I'm very unfortunate that the tools guys outside are taking away people. But I know this is going to be great. Thank you very much for coming, Lutz. And please do an introduction to yourself. Thanks.
Nobody knows that I'm Lutz Donnerhacke. Nobody had even proved my existence here. So I claim to be this person, and you may believe it or not. This is an interesting point. It's the point that has to do with the subject here. It's the problem of identification. Identification over internet might be a problem. Identification for election is crucial. So, but later. Okay. First of all, a short introduction why I talk about such a strange thing, election. Well, it's very easy. I'm chair of a union or a non-governmental organization, and in Germany we have some problems with bureaucracy, especially with the financial organization. And they said, you are a registered organization, but as a registered organization, you have some benefits from some financial benefits, and the real the reason behind these benefits is that you are doing something for the public, and we didn't see any action from you since years. So we need an action. We need an action which can't be denied. And the best action we can do is taking part in the election of the German Bundestag. The most prominent event every 4 years. It can't be ignored by the bureaucracy, and that was the reason to start with this project. But back to the basics. What is an election? What is an election? What do we expect from an election? An election needs to be secure, it needs to be easy. Every party has to be a good feeling on every step on this process here. Otherwise, we run into trustworthy problems. If there's an election and somebody claims, oh, there was a mistake, somebody is going wrong, then we have a problem. Even if the claims are not true, even if everything was okay, but might be too complicated. We already seen solutions, election solutions, which are so complicated that nobody was able to use it. But there is no intent in using the man's here and the woman here. The arguments do not correlate with the sides, but these provide a wide spectrum of requirements. Take the first one. Everybody should be able to vote. It's a clear requirement, but should be vote only once, and should vote only in his region, or in the area, or for the topics he is allowed to. It's contradictory. Then we have the problem that all choices need to be untraceable. We need a secret election. On the other hand, it must be provable. You must be able to find out that every vote was voted as given. No vote was exchanged. It's a hard problem in every election. We have the problem that must be easy to vote. We have a lot of people which are going to vote to an election, from very old people up to very young people going first time for this election. We have, in most cases, a very short time frame for a lot of people. So if we make it too complicated, we have seen it in America using some punching machines. They are too complicated to use or took too much time, and they weren't not able to provide voting for all voters in the on this given day. We have seen it in Africa, where voting might be so complicated to come to the place, to the voting office, that it might that votings are extended to from 1 day or 2 days to a week or 2 weeks, so that everybody can vote where required. Okay, what's the classical approach? The classical approach to do a voting is using paper ballots. They are very hard to handle. If you are going out there and saying, that's not that problem, I prepare some ballots, print the options on the ballot, push it out, see them voted, collect them together, count them, everything is fine. That's not true if you are going to a large scale. If you are going to a large scale, you do not have the possibility to supervise every step. You are not able to supervise the printing of the ballots. You are not able to supervise the distribution of the ballots. You are not able to supervise the voting itself. It must be voted. Have you ever tried to fake an election, real one? It's very easy. You are going into the election office, and you get a paper ballot. Might be you get two ones. Might be you have prepared one, bring it with you. And then there's a point where supervision is cut off. It's the voting process. In this step, you are hidden from all supervision. You can pull out your own voting ballots, put it on the table, write your choice multiple times on these ballots, and then you put them together to a thick bunch of paper. In most cases, it's very easy because the papers are very large. And then you're going out of the secret place saying, this is my one ballot, and put it in. But it's not one, it's three, it's four. So it's necessary to provide a good supervision. But we can't change this process. Elections are the real symbol of democracy. If we are going and saying, oh, we have another one, we are risking one of the fundamental points of our community, of our society. We had some other problems with paper ballots. For instance, how can a paper ballot be valid in providing the right choice of options? In one of the last elections, we had a problem in Germany that one of the persons on this ballot paper died. It died just on the day the election takes place. And we had a long discussion after that because all people voting up to the time the person was died voted on using another environment than those knowing that this people has died on the afternoon. And was proposed to do a re-election in this area. So we have a real problem in fixing mistakes or in keeping it updated. We need, if we are doing election, we need to have clear deadlines for every step. Keep this in mind. If you are going to move it to another area, to another technology, keep in mind you need definite deadlines for every step. You have heard about the elections in Afghanistan, where more votes were found in the ballot boxes than people was able to vote in this area. And you also know the solution for this problem. This election was not valid, but the winner of this election is the winner. If you transfer a classical approach to another medium, we have to make sure that such problems will not be transferred too. It's not easy. Several proposals for easing elections have tried out. One of them is to replace the paper ballot itself by voting machine. The reason is to shorten costs, to ease the election, the counting especially. Some elections have very complicated rules to find out who is the winner and who is not. Sometimes very sharp line between winning and losing. And so they hope to introduce a machine which is more trustworthy than a couple of people counting votes. The first impression was to cut down the paper and say, we do not need so much paper to waste. If we are using a machine, we have no paper anymore, and that's fine because we do not need it. But after some mistakes, after some horrible errors on these machines, it was required that every ballot machine, every voting machine, has to print out a ballot. Internally, externally, it has to be seen that there is a paper. So if anybody says, oh, I do not trust this machine, we can pull out all the paper and do it in the classical way. What we need is, we need all the stuff as before, because we are needing voting office where the people can go to. We need all the supervision as before, but we introduce a very valuable attack vector. If somebody is able to attack such a machine, especially all the machines are the same, he is able to manipulate an election in a very easy way. And it was shown many times that it's possible to manipulate these machines. What we had here a problem in Germany. The Chaos Communication Club shows a problem with these machines in handling, not in internally, only handling. They use the same technology, the same technique as traditional. They say, okay, we get the ballot or the voting machine, we get them in, we put it in a room, close the door and leave it alone. Nobody can modify it. That's not true. You can modify a machine without opening it. You can't modify paper ballots without opening the box. And they were able to show that if you have the machine in a room and you are able to access this room, you can modify the software in this machine without opening it, without opening any lock on the machine, simply because they had interfaces to the outside and these interfaces were broken in some way. After several years of trying out voting machines, we have generally a bad feeling on these machines. If we are talking about electronic voting, everybody thinks of voting machines and everybody thinks of, I do not want this. Give me my paper bag. And there's another way to do this and saying, okay, let's cut cost. We do not need stuff. We do not need offices. We do not need paper. We put all the things on the internet. Okay, we are not able to verify that the people are allowed to vote here. We are not able to identify the people. We are not able to even hide who has voted for which option, this this whole system is very, very successful. You all know Doodle for voting. Everybody heard about? Ah, somebody. There are a lot of services out there saying, you open up, I need an election for the following point, and then distribute a link to all the people who should vote. And everybody is going there and saying, I'm who, and I vote for the following points. You see the full list. It's easy to set up, it's easy to use. It's no secrets, no security, nothing. We can't use such a scheme for a real election. We can use it for getting an impression on a subject. In order to make an election over internet, in order to fix the problems with internet voting, forget about the machines. I will never mention them. It's necessary to understand what is an election. What happens if somebody goes to vote? There are three main steps. The first is to identify the person and to provide the person a token which says you are able to vote on the following subject. You are able to vote in this area for the following ballots, and you are able to vote once. You all know this. If a large election comes up, the regional Meldebehörden, the regional people offices send out a lot of paper saying, you are invited to go to the election, your number on the list is blah, 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 your voting blah, blah, is blah, blah, blah. Please bring this card with you if you're going to the following office. What they need is, in background, they need a voter database. They need a list of all people who are able to vote. You need a deadline for this. You need to say, from this point on, this voting list, voter list can't be changed anymore. These are the people which are allowed to vote, even if they die or not. Then you have to distribute the tokens in any way. Either to go face to face, or send it to a postal address, or send it via email. Next point is people coming to the office, the voting office, and saying, oh, I'd like to vote, here's my token. They get a paper ballot. Take it. And they are marked out in the voter database. So if they come back later, they get said, yeah, you already voted. You do not get a ballot anymore. That's important because it's possible to vote at many places. You are able, for instance, to vote using letter office, sending in letter in the town, in city hall, and saying, this is my vote. You have a deadline for this. After that, the voting for the voting office, the voting list for the voter office is closed. And if you are thrown out on this list, you are not able to vote in the voting office. So, this process is there to make sure that everybody can vote only once. And then we had a very interesting point, a very interesting process, a very interesting step. It's the secret voting, and then the collection and summarizing up of the vote database. So we have another deadline, it's the deadline of collecting all votes, and then opening the box and count the results. The interesting point is to keep all these processes, because they are so fundamental to the democracy, that we have to transfer every of those steps directly to the internet. That's something In most cases, this is very simple because it's all well-known problems in the cryptography area. If you want to put out a token to somebody, that's a known problem. You do not need to use or to implement Kerberos for this. Somebody has to go to the city hall saying, here, I need a token for getting to the ballot server. I need token. No, you do not need that. You can simply put out certificates. Certificates are fine, especially if you are thinking of a large scale. That's our problem. We want to do an election for the whole German people, for the German Bundestag. So we can't do it on a single server. We can't do it on a single town. We need persons in every town, so that people who want to, are interested to go in and say, I'd like to vote, where's my next registration agent? And we need a structure to manage these agents so that we get a certification structure up to the voter. Of course, these agents must be trustworthy. If you have somebody in this structure which is not trustworthy, is able to produce a lot of voters. That's the downside. The good side is that we do not need a database anymore. We have a hierarchy of certificates, so all we need is to check that the certificates are valid. If we have a valid chain, we had a valid voter. And the certificate contains who is the voter and what can he vote for. Then we need the we need to make all these people, or we have to remove the personal information from the certificates. There we use the well-known technology of blind signatures. They're sending in, I'd like to have a ballot, but I number this ballot. My ballot paper, my electronic ballot paper has a number, I give this number, I produce this number and send it in. And I have a registry which signs this ballot paper and pull it back to the user without knowing what is what signing. This is a blind signature. Blind signature works with a very special scheme. It says, if you want me to do a blind signature, if I have to sign something I can't read, I can't understand, I can't read, I want to make sure that you are sending me exactly what you are supposed to send me. So I do not expect you to sending me single ballot. I expect you to send me 100, 200, 300 ballots in, all with different numbers. And then I select one of them and say, and now I'd like to get the keys for all others. And then I reopen this, look on the ballot numbers on the ballots, all these must be valid, must be the right area code, must be a random number. We check the randomness of the ballot numbers. And if 200 of these ballots are sent in and 199 are correct, we assume that the one we have not chosen to open is correct too and sign it blindly. So we do not know the number in this ballot we signed. The only person knowing this number is the voter itself. The first step is done by regional agents. The next step, the blind signatures, are done on central server. They both need not to be connected in any way. The only point you have, the blind signature server needs to know how to check the certificate chains. And then we can make the deadline saying, okay, everybody has his ballot, and now we're starting voting. We have just a different server, or maybe a different run by a different organization. And if you are going to the server, you get, you bring in your ballot. You have a signed ballot here. It was blindly signed. Nobody knows the number but you. And if you are providing such token, you can vote with this. And then we are doing a very simple thing. We publish everything we had. We publish a list of ballot number, blah, 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 voted in this way. Ballot number, blah, voted in this way. Ballot number, blah, voted in this way. We publish the whole certificates. We made the following certificates. In this area, the following certificate numbers was generated. The following certificate numbers were generated, large list. Now we are able to check. We are able to check that no more blind signatures sent out than certificates was sent out to the people. Just calculation of votes. It's not possible to bring more certificates, more signed ballots out than have certificates coming in. Because we are publishing all these lists, everybody is able to check that his personal track of vote is correct. Especially the last list, the list of which ballot number has voted in which way, becomes public. Because the voter knows the number of his ballot, he is able to check my ballot. This is my one, is correctly in the large list. My vote was counted correctly. Have you ever count voting in the real world, real paper, sitting in such an office and counting? I've done it several times. Now, every time I'm there, I'm making a special note on the ballot, making the cross a little bit strange, so that I know that's my vote. And on counting, I keep an eye on my vote and see, oh, it's correctly voted. This is very complicated in a normal case, but in this case, very easy. So our hope is that everybody saying, oh, that's a very, I take part on a very strange election method, but I'm able to check that my vote was voted correctly. And we hope that we get a large people checking the results, much more than now. That's the whole process. Technically speaking. First, you need a lot of people going out. You need certificate holders, for instance, PGB. You need blind signature server, classical technology, nothing special, simple web page. And you need signed ballots for voting, the voting process, simple web page, nothing need to be done. Ha, stop. Here, step two. The voter has to generate a lot of ballots. It has to generate it in a cryptographically sound way. Nobody can do this. So we need to provide software for this. Bad thing. We have a Java applet for it. It's open source and we recommend to compile it itself. Nobody does this. The process is very easy. You simply choose a lot of numbers at random and make an RSA signature over that, multiplying the RSA signature with random values, keep track of them, send in on a request, put out a lot of random values, but one. It's a little bit number tracking, a little bit large, big mass arithmetic, nothing special. So the rest of this is going to a web service, to a web page, and we hope that it's possible to follow this process. But not the whole case, not the whole story. First, we had unexpected stuff requirements. To put out regional agents all over in Germany, you need all the connections you have. you need all the non-governmental organizations, you need all the local Unix users group, you need all those guys who are addicted to an internet or know what the browser is and have a trustworthy profile. That's the next point. So those people need to be educated. What should they do now? What's important on this? You need material for this. We need the software. We need other alternative clients for alternative systems. Java client is not enough. And we had very poor documentation. But the only thing we can do was to start with it, because we had announced that we want to do it, and we can't move the schedule for the election. We want to do it on the same day. In 2005, it works fine. We got a lot of votes, and we proved the system is working. In 2009, we failed miserably on this point. Not on every other point. We may failed on this point. We are not able to request the stuff. We are not able to get people who are willing to spend time on such a project. And there was a simple reason for all these people who are interested in internet things and interested in politics are completely busy with a single subject in Germany: internet censorship, internet censorship, and internet censorship. And every week a new version of it. So nobody has time to build the agent network, and we have to cut down the whole process this year and to stop it, because we are not able to distribute the keys, we are not able to register the voters. In 2005, we had a problem that nobody was willing to write about. If you are going to address people, you need press coverage, you need media coverage, you need reports in radio and TV. But if you are talking about internet, you do not get it. If you are talking about children, you get it. Okay, so what we are doing, we organized a child election on the same day as the German Bundestag election, nearby the real voting offices, all over Germany. That needs rooms, people staying there, all the organization stuff. We need distribution of documentation, we need blah, 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 blah. And we need, of course, paper ballots. Paper ballots was one of the easy parts. The easy part was to ask all the members of the German Bundestag supporting our children voting project. And everybody, of course, it's voting time, was happy to help us with producing copies, with making new ones, etc. Was fine. Took me about 2.5 months only on the telephone, talking to each of these members, clearing who is coming in, who will collect the paper ballots, when will it happen, where can he go afterwards, where can we make a press conference with this special member for or after voting. It's a lot of work. And we need a lot of people in these areas to say, I am willing to spend 2.5 hours in this room guiding the children on voting, and after that, collecting the voting counting. And all these elements had a simple background on pushing the internet election into the press. We had partial success. In the meantime, the acceptance for internet voting experiments are very poor, especially these large ones. So we decided to redesign the whole process and open it for everybody, saying if you want to make a secret election, go in, make your distribution of keys, make your blind signatures, make your voting ballots, let's vote. And because we have so less time, I ask for questions.
Lutz, have you followed the Austrian students voting in this summer? Because it was a completely different way of e-voting.
Not really. Only what you have told to me.
Okay, so we go afterwards and talk about that one again. Because there were no blind signatures involved in that one.
Yeah, most of this system has this problem.
Right, questions?
So if I understood the idea correctly, you are going to publish the tokens and then which party the token has voted for.
So no, we are not publishing the token. We hand it out face to face to the people who are able to vote. We need, this is a token, voting access token. The personalized one says you are able to vote on this subject. This is a special token. It's not to be published, it's to hand out.
Okay.
If we publish it, everybody can use this token and impersonate the other person.
Yeah, I see.
I see a big problem in all these e-voting things with the fact that a normal vote, that the system of a normal vote, every average person can look at it and can say, yes, I think this is okay. But as soon as we go in e-voting, there comes crypto stuff and other things in there that in the end, only a few academic people or people that really are in this topic can give a judgment if it's okay. And isn't this a big disadvantage of all these e-voting things?
Yeah, that's correct. You have to be very careful where and when to use cryptography. We choose to use cryptography on two points. One point is handing out the tokens because we do not want to collect voter database. It's method of choice. You have either to understand that there's a database, something out there collecting all the names. And then you have to provide a token too, but the token is very simple. You get, in principle, you can put out this token with the from the city hall people. If they are print out the normal election vote, they're sending out some numbers on a card. If they print out another number on this card, it doesn't matter. We only need this number on this card. That's the whole reason for it. Because we are not able to modify this printing process, we need to go out and give them the number face to face. That's the one point. And we're using certificates only for, certificates are most cases understandable as there's this, a document which is signed by somebody. And he needs a permission to do the signing, so we need another certificate. It's a document saying, yeah, I'm able to sign this, and we had another certificate. That's a certificate chain. It's, in most cases, easy to describe and will be understood by a lot of people because certificates are not that unknown anymore. Blind signature is a completely different thing. Because we are cutting down this blind signature process to a localized version of software which says you can play with it. Just try it out what happens. You generate a lot of numbers, your ballot numbers, you providing them for blind signing, and you can try it locally. What will happen on this? What will happen if you are putting it really to the server, all this list, and the server says, unblind all but this one, you can try it out, and you can play around. The code is not that large, it's not multiple pages of paper. It's, we try to stick it to one sheet of paper printed. So it's not that complicated. We do not do a lot of securing stuff like padding or obfuscation of signatures. We try to make it as simple as possible without risking security and in this point. And we hope that might be understood. All other steps, counting, giving a vote, are without any cryptography. You have a valid token, you can put it in, and it appears on the list. That's all. Nothing more happened. So you have you need to understand certificate and blind, because blinding is a little bit difficult, you have something to play with until you feel good. Yeah, but you are right, and a sheet of paper is much, much more easy to understand and much more easy to fake.
You said that the government office sends out papers which tells the people where to go to vote to. Same in Austria. I get mail from the Vienna government. Here's my polling place. Here is my ID. But this is just for me to know where to go to and to help the guys at the polling station to find me on the list. There's no security on that thing.
In Germany, I have a different experience.
It's just for in Austria, it's just a guide to helping the voters to find the right place and a helpful hint for the guys at the polling station to find me in their voting list. It is not an authorization to vote. This thing alone is not enough for me to vote. I have to show my passport or any other.
That's fine. ID. In Germany, it's different. The card you get from your government office is sufficient to vote.
No, Austria isn't. Okay. So which means that printing a token on that card in Austria, kind of, because that thing is sent on plain open, not quite open, not quite a postcard, but it's a normal mail. There's no security on the transfer because it is not needed. It's just a guide for voter and voter.
I do not understand why in Germany these cards are enough. It might be possible that in most cases the voting office has so small and regional area to deal with that the people sitting in mostly know the people coming in. Might be possible. I'm coming from very small and closed area on my town. Almost all people know each other. So it might be possible that I have a complete misunderstanding of this. But on the other hand, the process is simply exactly this. If you are going to countries which have no identification card as here, you have exactly this. You get a voting token, you have to register somewhere, and you get a token. If you have this token, you are able to vote in this election.
Yeah, but I don't think we should want to emulate the American voting system.
It's not only the American one.
British as well, but I don't know about that.
But on the other, you're right. We can move from a token to an electronic identity card given out by the government. So we have to wait for 2 years. Then everybody has an electronic card, and everybody's able to prove its identity having a card. I have a card, so I am the person. I do not know what's the right solution for this. This is a crucial step. It has to be think very clearly what should be done on this step. Please think it. Consider this as a sick point, as a point to make clear your mind what happens here, and what is needed on this point. We need an identification. We do not need an authorization here. Difficult.
Right, we're way over time. Maybe one last question and a short answer too, maybe.
Thank you. Lutz, you described a very interesting process for voting. I didn't understand what's the advantage for the simple voter which does a one-step, one-shop voting at the moment, which costs him half an hour every 4 years. One sentence, please.
You can use the system on many cases, especially on organizations. We have queries from the new German party, from Pirate Party. They want to do their internal elections on the system. It's much easier if you are not need to go out and if you do not need to make all the preparations before. Preparations are the crucial point. It's very costly. The voter is not the point on the system. Yeah.
Anyway, yes, I'm very unfortunate that we have to wrap it up at this point. Lutz, thank you very much for your talk there.